check for Bondays in that area. Can I see your high speed binos real quick? You got your fucking camera working? Videotaping right now?
Only for lucky.
Stafford.
What's up, buddy? Got a good scratch.
I kinda like
balls
this
are sweaty
spot.
Today.
Zwilling.
How's it going? Keep alive. Welcome home. All
right, this one, we'll be right up here.
I say we fire when like, they're playing the attack.
It's right there. And here's our fighting position. Phillips. Turn gobble.
I've been up for 36 hours.
36 hours.
It's really hard to stay awake after that long. And here's the crow's nest.
Kill.
Crow's nest is where
you know
it's at,
better,
baby.
You know what's better than Outback? Peanut butter and crackers. I'm a murderer.
10 times better than the Outback.
11 days in the wake up.
11 days, baby.
And all we gotta do is survive or not.
Your double digit midget soon will be single digit midget.
But if Heaven had a phone and you could talk to those guys, what would you say to them?
Thank you. Don't thanks. Just, you know, not even just letting me be here, but doing for what they did, you know. I guess, not that that this would even be necessary, but that I couldn't be more proud of them. You know, they did what they were supposed to do without ever even having to be told. You know. Because first of all, I'd just be glad that I could talk to him and just look forward to seeing him again someday.
And after the storm, run and run as the rains come, and I look up. I look up on my knees, and out of luck, I look up. Night has always pushed up day. You must know life to see decay, but I won't rot. I won't rot, not in this mind and not in this heart. I won't rot. And I took you by the hand, and we stood tall, and remembered our own land, what we live for. There will come a time you'll see, with no more tears, and love will not break your heart, but dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there, with grace in your heart and flowers in your hair. Exactly what was true, but oh no more. That's why I hold with all I have, that's why I hold. And I will die alone and be left there. Well, I guess I'll just go home. God knows where, because death is just so full and man so small. Well, I'm scared of what's behind and what's before. But there will come a time you'll see, with no more tears, and love will not break your heart, but dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there with grace in your heart, and flowers in your hair, and there will come a time you'll see with no more tears, and love will not break your heart, but dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there with grace in your heart, and flowers in your hair.
Words chosen few and what they mean to me. I'd have to say they're God's selected few. Heroes. There's nothing or no one better than the chosen few.
There's nobody tighter than the chosen few. We're spread all across the world now, but y'all still remember who. The guys that jumped in, to the guys that served in OAF-10, to the new privates there now. You're part of the chosen few, so.
The two words of chosen few, you know, when I first got into the chosen company, you know, I mean, I thought it was just, I thought it was just great that they were using a name like chosen. You know, most people use Alpha, Bravo, Charlie. You know, I felt like it kind of distinguished us, you know. And the fact that they used the name of chosen few, I mean, you're in a company, all right, and you're, you know, the name of that company is Chosen, and your motto is Chosen Few. I mean, you feel like you are a select individual who has been picked out of a large group of you know, other soldiers and put into this company of Chosen Few soldiers, you know, and they've picked the best, you know, of the best. They picked the cream of the crop, and by being in Chosen Company, that's what I felt. I felt like, you know, I was on the Olympic team. You know, I was in there with people who knew their job, they knew their job well, they were willing to train up and take as much time as necessary to make sure that everyone else, you know, who was selected met up to the chosen few standard.
Probably the greatest thing I'll ever do in my life.
What's that?
Is just being a part of that. It was a chosen few. Yeah. It felt, you know, unique. We weren't just, and not to say that other units are just, but we weren't Charlie Company, we were, you know, Chosen Company.
Bella, as soon as I got off the helicopter on that COP, I couldn't believe that we were there. The first impression of Bella was I was probably gonna die there. I don't understand why that COP was even there and it was so small. And just hearing about it, I heard about Bella before I even got there. I heard about how many contacts they get. I heard about Second Platoon, chose a few, always getting in contacts. I was a replacement, so I was really nervous about arriving there.
All right, OP1, looking down at Bella. And up to the north. We have TCP up here. All the way up. Speed bump to the top, the ridgeline. There we go, south. Driver OP. The valley to the northeast. West.
It was like living in a fishbowl, and we were, you know, basically we were the goldfish in there getting
picked on almost every other day, several times a day. Every day was in a new, different adventure. And when things were slow, you know, we were doing fob maintenance, doing the upkeep, fortifying the place. We never knew, you know, when the summer, you know, fighting season was going to start up, you know, what was going to happen to us there. You know, we thought, well, we could get overrun, you know, any day. And we started getting, you know, all the rockets coming in. And we just kind of really started honing in on some of our skills, quick reaction, attacks, and whatnot.
That went pretty far.
Hey, see if you can hit that fucking that peak up there. Fucking, you know what I'm saying? Where the Bondi is? That shit up there. It's to the left a little bit. There you go.
Oh, I saw it.
Yeah, those are gonna be close.
Okay, up,
just no, not that much, not that much. Okay.
That's
it. Fuck. But you know what I mean? Like a fucking inch will give it.
Look at it grinning like a mule eating sawdust.
We shot Pakistan today. I didn't feel
like that. Alright. Grinning like a mule eating sawdust.
I'll tell you, Lucius, I feel pretty good right now. I got a little trouble because I tried the best bit on.
Hey, That's it. We're good.
One time we had 11 ticks in one day that I know of. It was on an app. We have one or two every now and then, and we'd have up to three or four, but 11 was the most that I remember counting in one day.
So a lot of the country don't know what a tick is. You want to tell them what a tick is?
A tick is troops in contact, basically any types of small arm fire, rockets, or any type of contact with the enemy.
Like fifth time we took some contact out here.
Same as me.
What's up?
Just another day at the office.
Do it. Oh shit.
Oh jeez. Oh no. Oh no.
Oh, that's horrible.
That's terrible.
Hate yourself.
That's terrible. Terrible, terrible if you're out and about in this type of weather. Terrible. Mm. Oof.
What just happened up there?
It's a freaking sandstorm, man.
Holy shit.
Alright.
Oh,
all
right. That dude's sucking on guard.
Yeah,
he's coming toward you, man. He's trying to fucking attack you.
Tell us why you think this spider should be voted Soldier of the Year.
Look at him, because his back was crushed right here.
Why are you touching it?
What the fuck is wrong with you?
And he's still alive and kicking. Fuck you looking at, dude.
Motherfucker.
Fucking Man vs. Wild fucking eats one of those raw.
Who does?
Oh, dude, don't do that.
I think the hairs are poisonous, mouth. I would imagine. Your tongue will fall off.
Poisonous?
Guaranteed. Tarantulas are.
Now, watch.
No, you can eat
them. I'm about to have a fucking panic attack.
If you freaking cut their head off, you can eat the shit out of them. And they're really good for you.
Look at that. He's still alive.
Yeah, dude, we see that.
Oh! What was that?
Oh, shit. Fucking blind.
There's
fire.
There's blood of light.
Oh, the fire's back up.
They started their fire again. Oh, wait. No, never.
Oh, my God.
Oh, they started their fire again. Oh.
My name has been withheld, okay? For reasons of homeland security. You'll find out later why, okay? We don't want everybody knowing who I am and where I've been. And we're going to give you a little tour of the place, show you around, and you'll see that Post 5 is the shit!
John Henry's pappy woke him up one midnight. He said,
"A little hot.
Yo, Baco! Here comes Baco!
Before the sheriff comes, I want to tell you, listen, boy. Said, learn to ball a jack, learn to lay a track, learn to pick and shovel too, and take my hammer. It'll do anything you tell it to.
Shopping cart. You're going shopping. You're shopping. What are you shopping?
So you had a sign for that?
Yeah, it sounds way signed for.
Must be packing your rocks out
of each other.
Here we go!
Oh! Sandwich! Alright, this got weird.
Alright. I just want to talk to my ranger buddies out here real quick. Staying in the rock is a big deal for this battalion, okay? Your forefathers have stood in this battalion for 3 or 4 years. And I'll tell you right now, you want to re-up in the rock, boy. Tell your ranger buddy next to you, what's your name?
Here, sir.
Where are you from?
Georgia, sir.
What's your name there?
Phillips.
Where are you from?
Go on.
All right, you guys just take it easy now. My shoulders.
You're done, Rainey.
Oh my God, dude.
Why are you fucking giving?
Hovater, snap, dude. Flip out, man. You're gonna take that? Get him.
Ow! Get shit away from me.
Oh my God, dude. What the?
Put an eye out.
Jesus.
What did you think when you found out you were finally going to Wanat? Like, when you only had a few days left, what was your opinion?
It's gonna be real bad. We already drawn up, it's called a movie called The Bloody Fourth, because we were supposed to go on 4th of July, but the Apache helicopter attacks up in Bella delayed us. Called The Bloody Fourth, we had everybody who's playing everybody. All mapped out, I was gonna go down. Intel's telling us 300 waiting on you. And we already know, we've been ambushed twice coming back from there anyways. In June, we've been ambushed twice. And we're just set up on us. They're already dug in, ready to go. So when we got the word that Wanat was finally coming down, pretty scared.
How did I feel about going to Wanat? I'd have to say I was scared. I really was. Hearing all the stories. We were so close with deployment ending. I was like, oh, I made it through the first one. Thank the Lord. But then again, it was my first deployment. I was a private, so I had nothing to lose. So I was ready for anything. I thought I was.
My personal feelings on that, well, I had never been out there, but I knew from the patrols that we had sent out there, we knew it was a very bad place. We knew the people didn't want us out there. And just because of the timeline being sent out there 2 weeks before we were supposed to redeploy back to Italy, was also another big factor in kind of questioning why we were being sent out there in the first place.
Or how I felt when we got told we were going to Wanat was, it sucks. But you know, at the same time, that was my family going, and just like family at home. If you know, family's picking up and moving, everybody's going. So it wasn't really a question. I didn't want to get separated from any of the guys anyway. That's who I felt comfortable being around. So if everybody else was going, I was going. I felt the same way as everybody else did, though. We don't want to do this. But I mean, our voice is only heard so far. So
Abad and I sat down, and pretty much that's the day I started smoking. We're outside sitting, and he's like, he lit up a cigarette, and he's like, man, I need to quit. I was like, quit then. It's not easy. Don't smoke. He's like, let me tell you something. He puts his hand on my shoulder, and he's like, have you ever had a cigarette? I was like, no. And he's like, all right, this is the time you need to have one. And he gives me one. We start talking. He's like, it comes down to this, man. We're going to Wanat. And all the bros have said every time they went out there, they've gotten hit hard with Dishkas, PKM. It was just nonstop battle every time they went out to Wanat, so that leadership could survey it and talk to the elders and tell them what's going on. He's like, this is the day you become a man. The day you set feet on Wanat is the day you become a man. And I'm sitting here trying to inhale this cigarette, choking my lungs out, and it's just like, oh my god, I'm gonna die right now.
Getting ready to go, we loaded up the Humvees with everything we possibly could: food, water, supplies, ammunition. When we got the word that we were going, the overall feeling of the platoon is we were really scared. Really scared. Everybody was. At every level, and I think that really intensified my fear. I was always nervous, I was always scared to go on missions, but when I saw NCOs and my leadership afraid as well, and as close as we were to going home, you know, we thought we made it. You know, we were just like, we might make it out of this thing alive no matter how many contacts we were in. And then we get word that we are possibly going to do the worst mission out of the whole entire deployment. So our motivation just plummeted. You know, we were all scared. Nobody wanted to go. We all wanted to go home.
That morning comes up, and there's trucks that were getting ready in case for QRF. They're getting the trucks ready. Most of us were going to fly in because it was just easier, especially the mortar team. We needed just to fly in, grab our 120 and our 60 and just put them in. And so we're all out there getting ready. Birds ain't coming in yet. And you just hear everybody, we're going to die. And Rainey. He said, and he was like, man, it's going to be nice. No one's going to owe me a debt. Because Rainey ran the table at the poker table. He a lot of people owed him money. Let's just say that. And we were joking around about it. And it was a lot of joking around, but you just knew by the atmosphere that it wasn't really joking around.
Sarna Gonzalez took me into his area where he sleeps, and I sat down. He told me to sit down on his bed. He had to tell me something about a mission or something like that. He lured me in, basically trapped me, and I was sitting down. I heard a little rustle behind me. And I looked back, and I saw these eyes and hands peeking through a poncho, and it was our tradition to just catch you. You had 24 hours to get your guy that it's his birthday and then beat him, basically beat him up.
He's a scrapper!
Look at him fight! Look at him fight!
How are you grabbing my leg,
Ray?
It's not even worth
don't
it!
Don't hurt him! He needs to go to Wanat!
Watch him fail! Come on, McCheg! Don't let him get you! Give him a McCheg! Give him a McCheg!
We need him for Wanat!
Wow. Oh, shit, I thought that was
a I didn't know that was a
Oh, he's getting loose. 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 Oh, shit.
Don't break his hip, guys.
Look out, look out, look out.
That's a good
fire
right there.
I got kicked.
Roll him nuts.
Okay. Oh!
That's what I like to see. That's how you fucking put up a fight.
Rainy,
I dragged my fucking forehead across the pavement.
Sorry, man.
I'm trying to grab fucking McKay and raise down my leg like all the way up here.
Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to watch the computer all the way.
I'm a senior citizen, man. I'm elderly.
Yeah, you're older than me now.
Here we are getting ready to go Wanat. It's the last two weeks of our tour that we got left in Afghanistan, and from the intel there should be, how many guys should there be?
They said over 100, right?
Over 100. They got fighting positions set up. We're going there. We got 2 weeks left. It's bullshit. I'm gunning. Mark 19.
It's quite possibly our worst mission.
This is what my turret looks like. Here's my number one man. And here's my second number one man. They're both the same
so,
standing.
I know we're getting ready to go to Wanat, and they've got discus set up. They've got fucking
fighting positions.
Rifles, fighting positions, OPs, let them know. But the only thing that I can concentrate on is there's a dude to my left right now that I thought there was a weight program in the Army. So why don't you go and scan over there?
What do you guys say?
Yeah. Woo.
Recording
of our
last days?
Yes.
Wow, I'm gonna die.
We're all gonna die! What?
It's our last mission, probably the worst one.
I've survived 14 months of deployment and I'm gonna die in the last night. The last 12.
At least a lot of people won't owe any debts.
That's true. I'll be in heaven laughing
at you. When we first pulled out that night, we all loaded up. I was in the first 5 Humvees that went up. Driving up there, pitch black. Man, it was dark. And our Humvee actually blew out a tire on the way up, Sergeant Benton's truck. And we rolled in, we circled up to that little field where Wanat was gonna get built. Kinda got out, pulled our rucksacks out, piled them against that. No kidding, right out of a movie. Lightning strikes and a torrential downpour starts. And that was our first night in Wanat. We pulled in, circled, lightning struck, and a torrential downpour started. It was raining so hard. Thank God Scantlin was in the turret, getting soaked. it poured all night. We were supposed to clear everything, but IEDs, but we just sat in the trucks, pulled local security.
When boots landed on ground and Wanat, I got hit with a train. That this is reality. This is gonna happen. At first it was like riding in the bird. It was just like, oh, they're gonna call it off. They're gonna call it off. Birds are gonna turn around. And they didn't. They said we're here, and we grabbed our gear and got off the bird, started going to work.
I took it from them that this was not a place we wanted to go. Regardless, like I said, when it came down to it, we did what we were told. We loaded everything up. Basically, we were down to a rucksack and an assault bag. That was what we were living out of, and that's what we took with us to Wanat. We had a 5-truck convoy, a couple of Humvees. Actually, all of them were Humvees at the time. We drove out to Wanat to set up the station a couple days before the 13th. The rest of the members of the platoon would fly in the day after, at about noon, and they would arrive with their equipment. The first night there, it rained, and of course I was a gunner, so I was sucking at life for the first night there, and I think it was Schmitty, pretty sure it was Schmitty, he was being an asshole. Decided to give me his poncho after I was already soaked. He's like, here, you want this? I was like, no, go fuck yourself, dude. And, but, you know, now we've talked about it, it's actually pretty funny. But, yeah, it was pretty miserable first night there. I had to stand guard all night and make sure everything was clear for the LZ for everyone else to show up the next day.
All right, well, we're recording here at Grand Shooting Site of Wanat. I just want to hear your thoughts about this.
Well, for one, we have 2 weeks left in country, and they decide to send our platoon out here to start building a fucking FOB for 126.
Yeah.
So now, as you can see, Scantlin and I are sitting out here in the middle of fucking nowhere, Afghanistan.
Well, let's take a panoramic view of what we're looking at here. I'll have you narrate what's over here. Looks like a bobcat over here, and
that bobcat's sitting on the LZ right now.
Oh yeah. That's some nice fucking sea wire over there. Yeah, I must say, that's beautiful. I'm very proud of that work I did yesterday, and didn't. He helped. Yeah, we got over here. Our fucking one-way road that leads to nowhere.
Dude, you gotta show them where we live.
Oh, well, we'll get there. We'll get to the good stuff. Don't worry.
Man, I'm really excited about it.
Yeah. And then we got the fucking A&A over here.
That's where we're probably gonna get attacked from.
Oh, yeah. There's one of the Death Mountains. Of course, that one way up there probably not gonna help either.
No, but we'll probably see them coming.
Maybe.
Maybe.
They probably live in the mountain.
And those are snipers.
They're gonna pop out and fucking kill us all.
Like fucking Vietnamese and shit.
One. Hello, everyone. We are at guard position, Thunderdome. And, we started out with just a very, very small hole. But, as you can see, it has progressed to this wondrous work of art, dirt art, as I like to call it.
And
this is Sergeant Meyer, right here.
Hello.
And this is this is Specialist
Butters.
Butters,
but everybody calls him Butter. Butters.
I'm Hovater.
You're Hovater.
Photographers. This is Specialist Promotable Walker.
All right.
And then we got
Tellez Mike.
Good. Yeah.
And basically, why do we have to build a big-ass hole?
Well, because these fuckers, see these people up here? They want to shoot at us.
You can't tell. They all look innocent and nice.
But they're not.
They're not. They're going to go up into those things up there called mountains and shoot weapons at us.
RPGs.
What not what?
Rocket-propelled grenades at us.
Yeah. So the hole will be bigger by the time this video is done, but we're
basically
probably...
This is the most sucky thing ever to do.
They knew what was going to happen. I mean, we all knew it was going to happen. If we knew it was going to happen, then we were just waiting. I mean, it was basically just a waiting game.
You knew the attack was coming?
Oh, I knew it was coming. From the first day we got there, I sit there and we pulled our vehicles up in and around the village. And, you know, we're sitting there, we get out, we look around, and I'm looking at the area. And I just remember thinking, we're screwed. We're screwed. You got a village here, you've got high ground right here with full cover from trees, and we're just right in the middle of it.
We knew before we went that they were going to hit us. But the first signs, first mornings we got there, we started digging in. Sergeant Pitts and Lieutenant went to go find an OP spot. They found one. Gun teams went up there, me, Rainey, all the gun teams, a couple other guys, Goblin, Phillips, and Brostrom, or Bogar went up there. And first thing you notice, first daylight, once everybody, all the villagers started coming out, just fighting age males, ready to go to town. No women, no children. Every time we've been there before, marked, packed, women, children. I do remember when that first day we got there, the mayor and the police chief hightailed it out, had some important meeting in Assadabad that they had to go to. They were gone. And we were like, yeah, okay, here it comes.
Is that one of the signs?
Oh, yeah. And they're like, yeah, we got some important, trust me, you don't have important meetings in Afghanistan, especially when you're from Wanat. You could care less. So, I mean, the first day we got there, we're like, all right, these guys are watching everything we build, stepping things off, getting the exact distances to everything. You knew it was coming, just didn't know when.
Day two, kind of hurting. We worked throughout the day on day one and throughout the night, and also pulled guard on positions that we had made. Food was getting slim because before we left, we decided to pack ammo instead of food because we were told that food was gonna come. And so we started getting hungry. Bottles of water started getting slimmer and slimmer. We start sharing bottles of water. So day two is when the suck started.
Here we go. This is what it's like when it's really hot in Afghanistan. About, what do you say? How hot it would be right now?
Too hot.
I'm thinking 120.
Get really lazy.
You get most of your work done.
We're building a fob. The King Chief's quick. 50-50. Mortar tube.
I don't know what to say. I'm just tired.
Say something to your wife.
I posted on my MySpace.
Hi, baby. I miss you. Take care of my gummy bear.
General, last week, the Army announced that it had exonerated the three officers who were issued letters of reprimand related to their actions prior to the Battle of Wanat. The independent investigating officer, Marine Lieutenant General, had recommended that two officers should receive reprimands. After your review, you added a third and concurred with the results. General, first, I'm interested in your reaction to the Army's decision to withdraw the letters of reprimand to the three officers. And second, would your recommendation concerning the letters of reprimand change based on any information presented to you by General Campbell, who was the Army official charged with reviewing and taking action on the independent investigation report?
In this case, Senator, what we did at CENTCOM, first I directed Lieutenant General Natonsky, supported by a very able U.S. Army two-star division commander, Major General Perkins, who, by the way, was the did the thunder run in Baghdad. But they did a reinvestigation of the circumstances in this case. And your characterization of our findings is correct. We did not recommend any action. What we did is provide the results of our investigation and then provided that to the authority that, that has jurisdiction, if you will, command authority in this case, which is the U.S. Army. General Hondo Campbell, a very distinguished, great soldier, in fact, just about to retire, has took that on, reviewed the investigation exhaustively, did a further review of his own. This is like a, you know, like any process where there is there was an original finding, then we reinvestigated another finding, then again a final review. We discussed that. I respect his view in this particular case. I support the process, but I did not change the finding that I affirmed after the investigating officers provided it.
Jace thinks his dad's a hero, and he is. And one of the motivating factors since the CSI study came out and implied that my son was responsible for the deaths of 8 of his soldiers, my quest is to change that, because that's not true. There was nothing my son could have done to prevent the deaths of those 8 soldiers. And those 8 soldiers died not because of the decision, anything that my son did. They died trying to protect each other.
Why do you think they were blaming Brostrom for the death of 8 other soldiers?
Dead men can't talk. It's easy. Blame it on the guy that died. It's absolutely ridiculous. You deal a guy crap cards and tell him to win with them. He did. That OP would have been placed anywhere else, none of us would be here. We all would have been drug off. No reinforcements would have got available to us. Brostrom, it infuriated me to hear that they're trying to blame him with this. The one guy that pretty much saved the day. Why not pin it on him? It's easy.
Here's the before shot of our fighting position. And we're not.
Ass. Straight up Vietnam shit.
Supposed to get hit pretty hard here within the next couple weeks, so we're building up our firing position. That's the before.
Because of the current terrain features that were there, right, there was no way that we could put an OP just out in the open anywhere. Okay, would we have liked to have had a better position? Absolutely. Was a better position available? No. When you, especially when you're starting from scratch, once we got out there, there was nothing. There was no heavy machinery. All the stuff that was supposed to be done beforehand was not done. So we had to basically improvise. Sergeant Pitts and myself picked the best possible spot. Not only were there trees in the immediate area, but there were also large boulders, which on numerous occasions helped save my life. I can tell you that right now. Lieutenant Brostrom, Sergeant First Class Zwick, they made the right choice by having that OP right there in that current position, because that was the best position that they had.
It was a bad spot, but I'd like to see a better one. You know, were there better spots? Yeah, but not that we could actually, I don't think. I still agree with them. You know, was my favorite choice, was my first choice at first, you know, but after hearing his reasoning, yes. You know, this is couple different ways I've looked at it. You know, they weren't there. You know, I mean, with what the guys that we had, the materials that we had, you know, if it had been further out, everybody at the OP might not even been bodies for people to bury. knows what would happen, you know. Second, yeah, I mean, in a way, and I don't mean this that it's his fault, but yeah, he chose where it was. He made a decision, you know. Hindsight's 20/20. You know, at the time it can seem good, but afterwards it's bad. And in all honesty, you know, I'm not knocking, this is myself included, every NCO out there, including, you know, Sarnes Wick, and all of us could have said something, and I bet he would have listened. You know, so I can't help but feel at fault too. You know, if I thought it was that bad, I should have thought about it, but I didn't. You know, I agreed with him, and I still do. Because who knows what would have happened if it had been further out or someplace else. Nobody might have been out of there.
The location of OP topside was, it was a crappy position. But it was the least crappy of everything else around us. When you put me at the bottom of a fishbowl, and I have to stay at the bottom of a fishbowl, if I go to the corner of the bottom of the fishbowl, I'm still at the bottom of the fishbowl. We did not secure the high ground, is the bottom line. And any decisions made after that, in trying to find the best location, the best defense, in my opinion, you have no right to blame anybody about the location. When I'm not on the high ground and not where any stratagem says I should be, don't point the finger at me saying you shouldn't have chose that spot, because that whole spot was wrong.
I had up in the crow's nest, which was shaped like, it was sandbag shaped in a horseshoe. We were facing the southeast and the east and partially west. And we had Specialist Ayers and Specialist Rainey up there with myself, our gun team. And then to the left facing east was Stafford. Sergeant Pitts was in there with him and Zwilling. And then facing to our east side or west side, we had Bogar, Specialist Bogar. We had Phillips, and Sergeant Gobble was in the middle of our, he was basically manning the LRAS scanning with that. So.
Zwilling?
How's it going? Cable live, or go home.
Alright, this one, we'll be right up here.
I say we fire over like, there or something. It's right there on that tree.
And here's our fighting position. Phillips. Sergeant Gobble.
I've been up for 36 hours.
36 hours. It's really hard to stay awake after that long. And here's the crow's nest.
Kill.
Crow's nest is where
you know
it's at,
better,
baby.
You know better than Outback? Peanut butter and crackers. Shit.
10 times better than the Outback.
11 days in the wake up.
11 days, baby.
And all we gotta do is survive or not.
We're double digit midget, soon we'll be single digit midget. Shit.
Additionally, to the east of Cop, OP, over to the east of Cop Kaler. They're going to throw a green smoke grenade over to the east of their location. 50 meters east of that green smoke, need you to come in hot immediately, as there is an AAF, RPG, and PKM team at that position. I'll copy.
Good copy. Just want you to, well, I'm gonna let you know it's going to be a change or close shot request. Ground commander's initials.
I go back to the mortar pit, and I sit down next to Abad, and he has the biggest smile ever on. I was like, yeah, I know, man, I know. And he was supposed to go home that day. He's gonna go home to his fiance, who was pregnant with his child. And I've never seen him so happy in my life. And as soon as I look away, I hear, I swear, like the only gunshot, single gunshot, and Abad hits the ground head first into the mud, and that's when all hell broke loose.
There's no, when they attacked, I mean, brought the house, everybody was cyclic. There was no, like stoppage of noise. There's no, you couldn't hear, you know, a single gun firing. There's no, all right, that's a machine gun, that, you know, that AK, that RPG. I got hit right away with the first volley of RPGs that hit. And the whole OP exploded. People were going everywhere. Not flying through the air, not just because they wanted to. And I can't, it just sounded like one long crackle. Just a huge, loud crackle. And everything was on fire, everything was blowing up, snapping. You could hear bullets hitting sandbags, hitting rocks, going by your head. Sounded like 200 machine guns firing with RPGs, is what it sounded like. Scariest thing in the world.
They're within hand grenade range at this time. Break. Then pull around and go to 50 meters southwest.
Altitude low.
Of that green smoke.
Altitude
over.
Low.
50 meters southwest. Roger. First 60 meters east, then 50 meters southwest. Good copy. Thanks.
All right, Jimmy. Hey, we're on the west hand side, left hand side of the valley approach, and we're not. We're going to look for the green smoke, and we're going to put some fucking 30 down. 50 meters east. Damn, it's hard to see.
I'm trying to see what's in the wall and what's not in the wall.
We're looking for the smoke, no joy.
Altitude low. Altitude low.
Joseph 6, Central 5-3.
Altitude low. Altitude
hey,
low.
Right here.
Where?
I'm trying to make sure he's not in the, in the OP. There's a guy just on the other side of these trees.
Pretty much immediately, the mortar section was hit by RPGs as well as the tow truck. Ended up catching the tow truck on fire, forcing the crew members to abandon the truck and move to basically the talk position.
The tow truck that was parked in front of the mortar pit blew up. And out of nowhere comes this tow missile. Lands right between me and Sergeant Phillips. And you could hear the fan on it start to whiz like it was about to blow. And I look at Sergeant Phillips, he looks at me. By that time, I was really scared. I was like, this is the time I die. We're all gonna die. And all I see, big burly Sergeant Phillips grab that tow missile. No weapon, nothing. Runs out in the middle of the day, in the middle of everything, and just throws it. And I'm just there, just like, what just happened? And he comes back, and I thought he was gone. He comes back. He's like, he baseball slides into the foxhole next to Abad. And he's like, took care of that. I'm going back up to topside.
Chosen 9, Battle 9. 9-3, Roger. Hey, they were on the right part of the house. It looked like they were looking for bodies.
One more.
All right.
Roger, copy. We're on the west part of the structure looking for bodies.
It's some shit.
Right off the bat, between that first burst and about the 10 strides that I took and got in the mortar pit, and it was like almost, it was one loud noise. And then when I, and just in that matter of seconds from peeking back over, I saw the tow truck on fire, I saw more RPGs, I saw tracers, and the noise was deafening and just chaos in its purest form was just the word, you know, there's hell on earth, stuff like that, but it was just chaos, pure chaos.
Hedgerow, any hedgerow element, chosen six.
Be advised, we're in a bad situation that we can't really get spots on rounds. If you see any green smoke, there's an OP that is just to the east of my location at the grid that was passed to you, Blessing. They should have smoke out and continue gun runs outside of their location to get at the enemy pushed back. Over.
Altitude low.
I'm coming in with rockets right out here a little farther.
Also, I understand you want some 30 or gun runs.
Roger. Negative gun.
There's smoke to the north of the OP on the right side of the building.
10 meters to the east
of that location are 6 suspected AAFs. Over.
Okay, same distance again.
10 meters east of HC smoke, east of the bazaar. Over.
10 meters. So
that's got to be kidding me.
I knew how bad the fight was where we were, but the fight was significantly worse at topside. And, just the fact that they held their ground. They didn't push back. They didn't draw back to a safer location. They didn't wait, you know, oh, let's move back here and wait for reinforcements that we can push back up. No, they stood their ground, and they held it. I think that's, I don't know if this has been mentioned before, if people have ever hit on it, but topside didn't get overrun. Topside was held. It wasn't like we were, when we pushed up to reinforce topside, it wasn't like there were enemy inside topside and we had to push them out. No, the guys were still there fighting. I mean, you're talking guys just shot to hell and they're still shooting. So, I mean, just that they held their ground. They didn't back down, they didn't quit, and they kept going. I mean, that's one of the things that kept the rest of us alive. I mean, that's the reason I'm probably sitting here today. Could you imagine if topside would have gotten overrun and they would have pushed down right into the, in the middle of us, there nobody would be alive right now.
Ready?
Ready.
Firing.
You can see muzzle flashes down here like fucking lightning bugs.
Yeah, roger. Followed up with rockets.
Roger.
There you go. That's how you do it. That's how you do it.
He lost.
Altitude low.
And it's nothing short of heroic. You know, those two moved, you know, through constant enemy fire, you know, while under contact, you know, and not only were they moving to a location that was under contact itself, you know, but that particular location, OP topside, was at a higher elevation.
I can't even begin to imagine the amount of courage and I guess I can say it, balls that Brostrom and Hovater had to charge through there like that. Because I can only assume their first reaction was, we heard about, you know, hearing about what had happened at topside, and just immediately, let's go. And it was literally right through the middle of where the enemy was sitting. I mean, you're talking, the whole area was 360 degrees surrounded by the enemy, and they went right through the heart of it to try to get to OP topside. So they had a lot more valor and courage than I did. I can say that much.
I guess Lieutenant Brostrom and Hovater came this way. And right here, when they came around, I guess they either got shot from up here or right here from these windows. It's right through here, it's a straight shot, both the top side and to the TCP.
I don't know how they made it. You know, I don't know why they went that way. But it was something. You know, I wasn't expecting it. You know, I was just calling up the status of what was going on in the OP. And, you know, here comes Brostrom out of nowhere, pops his head over the sandbags, asks me what's going on. You know, it was good to see him. He was like kind of almost comical at the time because he just, you know, popped up like a gopher. And I don't know, he just, I didn't even know he, I don't know who he had with him. He just asked what was going on and he just did what needed to be done. Went right to it. That was the last time I ever saw him.
I have no idea how they even made it up there. I mean, we were in a fight almost 360 degrees up there, and then what they ran through, you know, we later found out where the enemy was. I mean, on the inside of my position, bullets were hitting, you know, on the opposite side of my sandbags and also on the inside. We had no, I thought they were shooting through our sandbags, and we found out that they were shooting right where Lieutenant Brostrom and Hovater ran straight up through, because they had it all occupied, and they had a straight beeline shot right to our position. We only had a, it was shaped like a horseshoe, but our, the opening of the sandbags was only about a body width, but they were shooting on the inside, and they ran straight through all that. They ran straight through it, and they made it up there. But Rainey tried to warn him. He tried to warn him that there was an insurgent right behind this big boulder, those 5 meters away from us. He was shooting up in our OP, and he was raking. Bullets were hitting everywhere, and we couldn't kill him. He only exposed his arm in an AK-47, and Rainey tried to warn him that there was insurgents down there, and I think, I don't know, I didn't see it happen, but I didn't hear Rainey's voice. I think he got him. I think that one guy killed a lot of people that day.
I didn't know anybody was coming for us. I know Rainey had called up with the survey, but I didn't know anybody was coming for us, and all of a sudden, I hear Lieutenant Brostrom's voice screaming to Sergeant Pitts in the northern fighter position. I couldn't hear what they were talking about, but I could hear him exchanging words, and I was like, how did anybody get here? How did anybody make it coming from the cop? Because there was no way to make it, especially the route they took. They basically ran past 3 machine gun positions 10 feet from them in that hotel, in that 2-story building. And when I heard Lieutenant Brostrom's voice, I was like, oh, thank God. And somebody got to us. And I heard him talking with Pitts. And then I heard they were up there. They're, I guess, setting up a machine gun position, from what I know, and heard Rainey yell that the enemy had got in the wire. Very vividly remember him screaming that he's right behind the rock, he's right behind the fucking sandbag, he's right behind the fucking sandbag. A whole bunch of shooting, a couple explosions, which I'm assuming were hand grenades. And I screamed at Sergeant Gobble, like, they're behind the sandbags, they're behind the sandbags. He stood up and shot 3 or 4 times, just kind of, not stood up, he couldn't stand up, just kind of propped himself up and maybe got off 3 or 4 shots, come back down, and that's when it all fell silent from the OP.
But we will have additional fallen hero missions to follow. I have a total of 9 KIA. Over.
God damn it.
Disbelief, anger, hatred, sadness, I mean, every basically every emotion that you could possibly feel in a moment like that. Upset that I wasn't there with them. Maybe thought I could change something. Guilt. Unbelievable. It's just like, you know, this ain't happening. There's no way, you know. We're, you know, 10 days from coming home, you know. This ain't happening.
The job of moving all the KIAs was left up to us, the guys that were had reinforced topside. And I think that was probably the hardest thing I'll ever have to do in my life was moving those guys and having to look them in the face as you carried them. So it's something I'll never forget. So.
Beyond Valor. Those guys fought so hard. I was wounded the whole time. But you should have seen those guys fighting. You should have seen them. Never seen anything like it. These guys were literally having the world come down. You could not look above the sandbags. Hell, you couldn't be behind the sandbags without getting shot. But no matter what that enemy did to stop us fighting, these guys punched right back. Damn, they're brave. It's beyond valor. Know that.
Basically, Phillips had taken an RPG right directly in his position and had blown out his side. And Ayers, I couldn't really see anything immediately wrong with him. Come to find out later, he actually got shot in the upper chest and the throat area. And I said Bogar and Rainey were both had some severe facial trauma as well. I couldn't tell with Bogar what exactly had killed him, but Rainey was definitely fragmentation. Parts of his face were missing. Zwilling we find later in some bushes. He was hit by an RPG. It blew off his leg. Pretty much he was still connected by a couple of tendons. I remember when we took Zwilling out, we had him on the litter, and we were trying to get him up the tier. Me and the first sergeant and a couple other guys were moving his body up to the secondary LZ to get his body evac'd out, and his leg fell off the litter, and I had to reach down and put it back on. But even after all that, that still wasn't the worst. The worst came when I found, when we found Hovater. And everybody there, you know, as badly as everybody was, that was the worst. That was the worst.
I seen Lieutenant Brostrom. He looked like he was praying. But it didn't make sense, not in the middle of a firefight. I seen another soldier, and he had his face shot. And I couldn't tell who it was at the time. But it was like, just ripped open. And I went further down and I seen Garcia. Garcia was split in half, crawling, screaming, help me, help me. Intestines, guts, everything just hanging out, and he's just crawling. It was like television. I looked down the terrace and you just seen bodies. Eight of my brothers in a row. And you just heard screams and cries.
There's a difference between being in a fight that you're winning and losing, and I knew we were getting our asses kicked right off. I mean, we at least at the OP, we were getting our asses kicked, and it was bad. It was so loud. It was so intense that seeing them fight like they did, you know, being wounded, and I mean, you have a choice. You could either keep fighting or roll up in a ball and give up, and no one did that at the OP. Everyone, we knew we had to fight. It was either that or die, you know. And then, in your mind, you tell yourself, I'm gonna die anyway, so there was no thinking like, what if I die? I'm gonna die. Definitely gonna die in this battle. Not gonna make it. It really messes with your head when you tell yourself that, you convince yourself that.
People might call, you know, soldiers heroes. I don't remember who said it. I'm sure it was somebody smart, but you know, heroes are the guys that don't come home. Those are heroes. You know, I don't feel that I'm a hero, and although I do look at some of my other buddies like they're heroes, but the guys that don't come home, those are the real heroes. You know, and I hope that, you know, they're remembered for their sacrifice, you know, that they were extraordinary men, you know, far from average. Even if they might have seemed that way on the outside. You know, they all had greatness in them. And they showed it.
As far as fighting, they were beating us in the beginning. But I think ultimately we won. They didn't kick our ass, you know. They gave everything they got. We killed them as they came. And we pushed them back. They got in our wire. They got close to us. I could hear their voices. They got that close. I thought we were going to go to hand-to-hand combat. I was waiting for them to jump over our sandbags. But they never took anything. But the thing that bothers me about the whole battle is we pulled out, you know. Here they send us into a place where it was important enough to establish this thing in the beginning. And we lost friends. And some of us got hurt or wounded. You know, we'll always have those scars for the rest of our lives, and you can't help but ask for what, you know, we pulled out. You know, why can't we just keep the base there and give them the big middle finger and just keep the base there, you know?
They were the elite, the proud, the chosen.
Just another day at the office.
And he was their leader.
Those guys fought their hearts out for each other.
Alone, and surrounded. They knew the attack was coming.
Oh man, the whole world was exploding around you.
In the end, the toll was terrible.
It was one of the bloodiest battles of the war in Afghanistan. 49 Americans held off hundreds of Taliban fighters who attacked their outpost in Wanat.
It's hard to remember, but I remember seeing it on CNN News about 10 days before we were supposed to go meet my son in Italy, that there was an outpost in the Kunar province that was overrun by hundreds of Taliban. There was many killed and many wounded. And I thought, my God, my son's in Kunar. So, it was a long Sunday. I waited all day, watched the news, couldn't take my eyes off of it. And, you know, so the whole day went by. So I was thinking at the end of the night, you know, maybe I'm just overreacting and worrying too much. And selfishly, maybe my son wasn't killed. And Monday morning, while I'm out watering the dogs and feeding up, my phone rang about 8 o'clock. So I answered it kind of in thinking, you know, good thoughts, but I was told that, you know, Pruitt was killed. It was a long walk to walk inside to tell my sweetheart that, you know, our son was killed. And I remember the hardest thing I had to do then was go tell my mom. And we drove over to see my mom and had to tell her in person that her first grandson was killed. It would not. And that's the last thing I remember because I think we collapsed.
It was a Sunday. We were going to the beach after church. We drove into the house. There was a van outside the house. We didn't know what it was, but we ignored it. And we went inside, and as soon as we got inside the house, the doorbell rang, and there was a female major and an Army captain chaplain who informed me that our son was killed in action due to small arms fire in Wanat, Afghanistan.
I think it, you know, it puts things in perspective as to what's important and what's not. And, I decided when Matt died that, this was the life that God wanted me to have. And I'm determined to make good things come out of it and good things come out of his memory. But it definitely puts things into perspective.
One day, if heaven had a phone and you could call up, speak to your son, what would you want to say to him?
I would tell him, first, I love him very much, and second, I'd apologize to him because it was me who sent him to Afghanistan. I regret the day that I, because I was ignorant about Afghanistan. I really didn't. Had been watching the news, and I got his orders changed from the 1st Cav Division going to Iraq and sending him to a hellhole, and I didn't know. And I should have just let it be, and I think he'd probably be alive today.
Having been around the military my entire life, in any environment where you put your troops at risk, your number one priority is to make sure that you're taken care of. Number one. And I think what happened in this particular command environment is that the command was pulled in so many different directions that they lost the focus of what was going on with this unit that they sent out there. They were getting ready to transition back, as I'm sure other people have said. They had a high-ranking officer in their command AO, and they were dealing with that. And from what I've read about this incident, you had the lieutenant and others calling back, talking about the nature of the enemy around them, giving data points that a commander should have picked up on. And that's just not my personal opinion. I think General Natansky in the CENTCOM report broke that down and laid that out.
I think what you're doing on behalf of the families is so important. When you had a 75% casualty rate, you know, the parents and families are going to be wounded forever on this, emotionally working through this situation. And so we need to know the answers. You know, really, what went right, what went wrong, and why did General Campbell see it differently than General Petraeus? And they're tough questions, and they might not ever be answered to everyone's satisfaction, but we have to go through this so that it won't happen again.
Yeah. The Battle of Wanat is a very controversial battle in any number of ways, but the one thing that is not controversial about the Battle of Wanat is the heroics of the chosen few that were there that day, and nine of them made the ultimate sacrifice. Three of those individuals happened to be from Georgia: Corporal Pruitt Rainey, Corporal Jonathan Ayers, and Corporal Matthew Phillips are all true heroes, and they not only fought bravely, but as I say, they made a sacrifice that you never want to hear families having to deal with.
The chosen few is a name that we might throw around here, you know, kind of smiling at, but it really is a serious thing to think about nine soldiers losing their lives, but bravery executing their duty. It's inspirational, it's sad, but it has very deep consequences for those of us that live in, to kind of allude to Lincoln in the Gettysburg Address, where he said, you know, there's nothing we can say about this ground to further consecrate it more than the blood that's already been spilled by the soldiers. There's nothing you can say about the chosen few that speaks louder than the deed that they've already done for us. And so I do think that it is our job as Americans to make sure that we carry on freedom for the next generation to come, and to tell the story about why not, about Afghanistan, about Iraq, and other sacrifices.
I've sat down with these surviving soldiers face to face, straight out of the soldier's mouth, the truth about the Battle of Wanat. Soldiers don't lie. And they told me everything that happened there before, during, and after. And as you will see on this documentary, and realize that it's not just an ordinary battle. It was a very, very large win, very gracious and honorable victory for the men of Chosen Company. Just shows the character of the chosen few. These guys didn't quit. They give it all. Some give it the ultimate sacrifice. Some, the ones who survive, will not never be completely free from it. They'll have to deal with it their whole life, just like we have. The documentary has set me free. I've accepted my son's death. I've accepted that the Army's not going to take responsibility for it. That's okay with me. The only advice I can give parents who have not had the opportunity to sit down with these soldiers is you're going to have to let it go. You're just going to have to let it go. You're going to have to deal with it in your own way. You're gonna have to ask for help. You're gonna have to accept your son's death. And knowing that maybe the Army did let them down. But what's more important is these guys give their lives for one another. They fought for each other. And our sons want we parents to acknowledge that and to honor them. Not to hurt and live in the pain of revenge or hate. But to think about, you know, what our sons would want us to be, what kind of parents, what we could do good to honor them. And I was fortunate enough to hear this many, many times from the surviving soldiers. And keep in mind, these same soldiers, year one, they were mad. They were angry. They felt let down. They felt they were sent out to dry. Year two, they're still mad. Someone went back in OEF 10 in 2010 for a second tour. Back to the same shithole. Unbelievable. What were they going through? Year three, some of them are back home. Some of them are in the Army. Some of them's out trying to go to college. They're trying to live a normal life. It's hard for them to live a normal life going through what they went through. It's hard for the parents of Wanat to live a functional, normal life dealing with the death of your child in the manner and the way that they were killed. It's the hardest thing to understand. It's the hardest thing to accept. And it's really hard to not blame somebody. But it's time to stop blaming. It's time to forgive. We will not forget, and we will never forget our sons. It's time to move on and to remember this battle for what it is. It was a hell of a victory. The cost was high, which what makes it so greater in history and days to come. Wanat should be memorialized forever. Lessons will be learned from it for years to come. My son will never be forgotten. Neither will any of the other soldiers, including the ones trying to make a life today. They're like a son to me today. I love each and every one of them.
Well, the last question that I ask every soldier, and being you're going to be a Ranger, I'm going to look at you as a soldier, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to ask you that question. If heaven had a phone and you could call up to heaven for 5 minutes to talk to your daddy, what would you say to him?
I love you and I miss you. I wish you were still alive so I can have more fun with you. And I'll see you again soon.
I walked through the valley of the broken and blue. I held my head down in despair. Climbed that same mountain to no avail, till he brought me here, where no trouble came.
Sacrifice so that others may live to tell the truth of a brotherhood born in blood, stained by love, can't be washed away by tears in this life without you. Your memory remains stronger than the pain. I know I'll make it through. Till we meet again, all the moments that we've shared, and I'll live to tell the truth, the chosen few. A lie for a lie was a deal that was made when the world came crashing down. As the battle raged, our worst fears realized. The dark day in July, when a storm of silence fell through a smoke-filled sky. A brotherhood born in blood, stained by love, can't be washed away by tears in this life without you. Memory remains stronger than the pain. I know I'll make it through. Until we meet again, I hold the moments that we've shared, and I'll live to tell the truth of the chosen few. Honor, valor, and love is what this brotherhood's all about.
born in blood, sustained by love, can't be washed away by tears in this life without you.